Well, you have heard the mother reading out chapter 6 of the book, The Mother. This is the first paragraph only. And maybe this is the rhythm that we will have during all our classes. To explain the first paragraph itself may take us quite some time, because there are many concepts here which need explanation. Almost every other word requires an explanation here in the first paragraph. So whenever we start the second paragraph, then we will hear the mother read it out and then we will take up the explanation. And as you can guess, the explanations would be mostly from Sri Aurobindo and the mother herself. But let's go back today a little bit to the historic view of this book. I'm sure all of you have a copy of that. But those of you who have this copy, this is an edition of 1984. You will see in this edition the manuscript on the left side and the print on the right side. So you have kind of Sri Aurobindo's own writing of this book. Actually, as we said, this is not a book per se. Sri Aurobindo did not write it as a book in itself. It was more in the form of letters to a disciple. At least one letter we know the disciple was in Gujarat. So later, it was in 1928 that these letters were compiled and brought out into a booklet called The Mother. Actually, most of these letters were written in 1927. And very interestingly, just 1 year before, 1926, all of you know the event that took place. That was the event of the Siddhi Day. Siddhi Day. The day of Siddhi, that the day of realization. On 24th of November. And it seems nobody knows exactly the date. Not even Nalineda himself remembers. But it was during that year, 1926. Well, further digging into the date and the exact period one can get, when Sri Aurobindo called Mira Alfasa mother. We do not know the date exactly, but it was during 1926. Some say it started in August, some say it was in October. But we are not able to give the exact date. But you know, some of these things we get from the diaries of the ashramites, the sadhaks at that time. Because some of them do mention that now Mira Alfasa is being addressed as the mother, or now she is being addressed as this. But that now we don't know the date. However, it's very interesting that after the descent of the overmind, which took place on 24th of November, when the ashram began officially, it was during that time, sometime, Sri Aurobindo for some time was almost to call mother, mother, but between mother and Mira, he would utter the first ma. Several times he said, and then Mira, not the mother was not yet coming out. But that must have been a moment in history when Sri Aurobindo ultimately uttered the word mother. Because it is not the question of just uttering the word the mother. Because for him, to utter the name mother, it means to manifest her. You say she was here before also in 1914. She came back in 1920, and when he called her only Mira. So it was a very conscious referring to Mira as the mother. So we do not know what must have been the preparation, almost I say, to call Mira Alfasa the mother. Well, after reading about Sri Aurobindo's yoga a little bit here and there, we come to know that right in the early 1912-1913, when Sri Aurobindo was recording his yoga in a book, Record of Yoga, we do come across some reference to the four aspects of the mother. But it was not until 1926 that it develops the four aspects. It is difficult and maybe even a risky affair to try to understand why he calls the mother at that point and not before. But as we see from Sri Aurobindo's letters, that it was only after 1920, after the mother returns from Japan, that there is a kind of a collective, a collaboration between mother and Sri Aurobindo in the sadhana where they descend into the inconscient. Sri Aurobindo would write somewhere in a letter that it was not until the coming of the mother that he could really start the yoga of the descent into the inconscient. So he needed the mother's shakti, the mother as the shakti, to begin this yoga of transformation. So obviously, calling Mira Alfasa mother was an extraordinarily significant moment in the spiritual history of mankind. And therefore, if we can call it In fact, if you read the whole book, you will see it's not only about the mother and her four aspects, but very interestingly, this compilation of letters gives the seed, the essence of integral yoga. I mean, if you want to really know about what this yoga is all about, you need to read nothing else but the mother. However, it is called the Bija Mantra, the mantra in a seed form. So it's all very compact. Every sentence, every word has layers and layers of meaning. So in a way, it's easy to understand this, but in another way, one needs a lot of explanation. It has the entire essence of integral yoga because it gives you the path to follow, and then the person from whom we get the grace to do the yoga. And also, as integral yoga, I mean, it's essential for this integral yoga to have a divine personality, to have faith in a divine personality. And that divine personality is none else but the mother herself. So we have a kind of a complete thing here, the path and the person to whom you surrender, the path and the guru to whom you surrender. So it is a book complete in itself. And in those days, I remember still when I was here in 1958, Savitri was not at all popular in those days. What was of more importance, greater importance, was prayers and meditations and this book, The Mother. So in my childhood, actually, I grew up only knowing about this book, The Mother, and prayer and meditation. It was much later that we came to know about Savitri, read Savitri in my college days. But earlier days, it was always the prayers and meditations and the mother. And in fact, I remember many people, the ashram sadhaks had learned, as we are learning nowadays, Savitri. They had learned this entire book, the mother. So it was a kind of a mantra. Whenever they needed to go into meditation or an internal solace or some kind of a, you know, silencing and inward withdrawal, they would recollect the chapter 6 about the mother, or the conditions of sadhana, chapter 1 and 2, etc. So what I mean to say is that first it was this book that was known to all the disciples of Sri Aurobindo and the mother. And of course, we don't have to exaggerate by saying that many who read this were almost transformed overnight. Because you get for the first time a direct description of the mother, of the divine mother. You see, nowadays, a lot of people have read and do read Savitri. But to tell the truth, Savitri is only the daughter of the Divine Mother. We call her Surya Savitri. or the daughter of the divine, Surya. But here we have the mother as the supreme incarnation herself. So it is the difference between Savitri and the mother here is that there Savitri is an embodiment, is an avatar, is a descent, is the daughter of the divine. So she has a different role to play. But here we have a direct description of who the mother is, who the divine is, kind of the mother of Savitri herself. And of course, as we see, the mother in her different aspects. So, the experience we would have of the mother here and the experience we would have of Savitri in the book Savitri are quite different. The mother does write, yes, the Savitri is a transformative force. But personally, on the level of yoga, on a day-to-day level of yoga, this is the book that comes of greater help, use, directness, contact with the sadhaka. It may be that Savitri is not understood by most people because it is difficult and it's not to be understood by the mind. But this book, The Mother, also is not to be understood. But at the same time, it penetrates your heart directly. I mean, just read the chapter 6, which we'll take up as the first reading. You have magnificent description of the aspects of the mother. So that is something that passes beyond your mind. And at the same time, you will see simultaneously it is penetrating into the heart, into your psychic being, into your soul. So, it was but natural that all of us in our younger days took to this book, The Mother. Not only took to this book, but in 1966, I took this book from the mother, and you can see her benediction on that. So, this was a kind of a thing I used to do, as I told you in my previous talks. Either on my birthday or whenever we went to the mother, we made it a point to buy something, and then, you know, it was very interesting. All of you know, Panditji's bookstall is right near the meditation hall. So before going up, we would get into that room, buy a book or a photograph of the mother and take it straight to her and request her, pray to her to give her blessings. That's how most of my books, it's only a few times that we got a book directly from the mother's own collection. I think she had a collection of her, of Sri Aurobindo's and the books, and her books somewhere, because she would call Champaklal and say, bring this book, and then Champaklal would bring that original Life Divine and she would write. But otherwise, we would buy this book or a photograph. All my photographs that have been signed by the mother were like that. So it is very easy, pick up one photograph, go to her and get a signature. So I was lucky to get this signature, Benedictio. And I see the date written here on 13-12-1966. It was not on my birthday, but it was the birthday of the Institute of Human Study, which was started at Hyderabad by my father. However, what I mean is that all this were our first passion. To read this book, The Mother. And as I was going through some of my notes, I've seen that it was in 1961, 3 years after my coming, that I still remember it was, I did not buy that book, but when I went to her on my birthday, I asked her for a book from her. I didn't know which book because I was too young to know anything about mother's books. I was maybe 13 plus. Very interestingly, she gave me the book Prayers and Meditations. There she wrote my name and gave her blessings on Prayers and Meditations. Of course, for a boy of 13 plus, you know, it was much too difficult. But that is how perhaps she put us on the path of some inner journey to path of yoga, it would be too much to say. But as a discipline, right from that age, I used to read one prayer at night, every night. Before going to bed, compulsorily I used to read one prayer. Because when I finished reading the book, I would come back right from page one, go on about it. So after prayers and meditations, I remember it was then this book, The Mother, because which we have read several times. And it's only much later when I went into the higher course, that is the college level of the ashram, that I almost touched the book, The Life Divine. Until then, it was only prayers and the mother. And of course, we used to hear a lot from our teachers, but personally, the books of Sri Aurobindo came into my hand only at the college level. So, just to narrate further, we, perhaps if I can really, if it's possible to jump back 40, 50 years in memory, because of the mother's presence, physical presence, I think, well, I may be exaggerating or maybe wrong, but maybe I can speak for myself. We never really thought of doing yoga. Because after reading this, the mother, you'll understand, when she was there physically, all around you, all about you, throughout the day, it is such a spontaneous movement, you know, like it is said, the sunflower keeps rotating wherever the sun moves. What I want to say is very spontaneous and natural. There was no effort saying, oh, we must do sadhana, we must do surrender, we must do rejection. Because it was a kind of a spontaneous living. Working, those who were elders, adults, they worked for her ceaselessly. They executed her command unthinkingly, without asking a question. So I suppose her physical presence had that great advantage that somebody was doing the sadhana for us and we hardly ever thought about doing sadhana, achieving this, achieving that. It was as Nolanida later remarked after when she left her body, that her physical body was like a ladder. People just climbed up on the ladder towards a higher consciousness without taking much effort, because when there's a ladder, you climb up pretty naturally, very much easier. But the withdrawal of our physical body is the withdrawal of that ladder. You don't have the steps to walk up. Now you have to rise in your consciousness. That, I suppose, is the difference between her being in the physical and not being in the physical. Where the effort the personal effort is more now. Not that people, I would not say definitely people were greater or problems were less. No, human nature was always the same. But then, if you read the literature of those times, the letters, the conversations, the correspondence, you have a general feeling that people were much more aware, awake, and at trying to go into higher consciousness. So that was the physical presence of the mother. And so in the beginning, this little book, which in fact is, I would dare say, is also the essence of Savitri itself. Because from the point of view of sadhana, there's no greater book than this. In fact, it's been called as the Matri Upanishad, the Upanishad of the Mother. It is typically in that fashion, like the Upanishads, the vision is direct, intuitive, no explanations given. Like the Upanishads, you know, there's no explanation, there's only the declaration of the truth. So here also Sri Aurobindo doesn't explain, he just almost notes down or intuitively the vision, the commands, as it. So friend, this is the introduction that I could give about the book itself. And then the necessity of reading this book. I just gave you the hint for your yoga. If you want to take up sadhana, the integral sadhana, read this book. It has all the milestones of yoga which we could practice on the individual level. And also, as we will take up the chapter 6 and we will see that we begin to understand who this mother is. Because when you are playing with her, being around with her, talking to her, joking with her, and taking her guidance in every little thing, I think we had taken her for granted. We were more attracted to her outer personality. We were charmed by the beauty of this wonderful person. And it was not until the early 60s when she withdrew into her chamber upstairs on the third floor that we really started missing her. Because we had gotten so used to seeing her so many times of the day. And people older than me, they could really go to the mother almost any time. So first it was the divine in the body, the physical human body, who had kind of attracted our souls. And then in the 60s, when she withdrew into that chamber, when people complained, "Mother, we do miss you," she said, "No, it was high time that you people have some inner contact with me so that you are not really always hungering for the physical body of the mother." She wanted us to develop an inner contact. I would say it was a kind of a preparation that we were given, that ultimately when in 10 years she would completely withdraw from our body, we would have some inner contact. And in one of the letters of Sri Aurobindo, right in 1936, it was 10th of August, 1936, that he writes a letter. Imagine as far long as back. In 1936. Sri Aurobindo writes, "It is true that the mother is one in many forms. But the distinction between the outer and the inner mother must not be made too trenchant. For she is not only one, but the physical mother contains all the others in herself, and in her is established the communication between the inner and the outer existence. But to know the outer mother truly, now this is what I want to emphasize, but to know the outer mother truly, one must know what is within her and not look at the outer appearance only, and not look at the outer appearances only. That is only possible if one meets her with the inner being and grows into her consciousness. Those who seek an outer relation only cannot do that. So in another letter, I remember the mother would say, "In thinking of me," writes the mother, "you must think not only of the outer person, but of what she represents, what stands behind her. For you must never forget that the outer person is only the form and symbol of an eternal reality. And through the physical appearance, it is this higher reality that you must turn to." So, if you remember these two letters, one from Mother and one and the other from Sri Aurobindo, it is necessary for us to read this book, The Mother, and especially chapter 6, to find out what she symbolizes, what is behind, as she says, what stands behind her. "For you must never forget that the outer person is only the form and symbol of an eternal reality, and to the physical appearance, it is this higher reality that you must turn to." So, thank God, we have in Sri Aurobindo's own words the description of this higher reality, what stands behind the mother. So, having said that, let me narrate to you one more thing. Also, let me at this stage warn ourselves that what all we are going to speak about the mother here in this class and the subsequent ones, we need to have a kind of a willing suspension of the old beliefs, because I'm aware that most of you here are from a non-Hindu background, which means that the whole concept of the mother is pretty different in Hinduism and in other religions. And also is taken for granted that the Hindu approach to the divine has been spontaneously quite different from what other religions have taught. So it may be a bit difficult for some of you to almost believe if what Sri Aurobindo has written can be true. You may start even with some questions in your mind. That's why I would say you will have to make a conscious effort to willingly suspend your old ideas, your religious background, Otherwise, it may be difficult to accept, it may be difficult even to understand this book, The Mother. For us, it was easy, but recently, as I told you, I was surprised to read from the mother in the agenda, where she says, the mother is not especially for the Western mind. In the beginning, it was a bit of a surprise, but then I understood her, that this question of the mother, especially chapter 6, other chapters one can understand and accept. But here, for example, in chapter 6, when she says, when Sri Aurobindo would say, the one whom we adore as the one is the consciousness and power of the Supreme. So how would you understand? Can you really believe that this mother whom we see here in the photograph is the creatrix? Is the one supreme conscious power? So there may be all kinds of doubts. But we in India have had the advantage of this mental surrendering to our Guru. So I think people have not really questioned Sri Aurobindo when he wrote about this. But there was one question here, once this book was published by our famous Kapali Shastri. And it was good he asked these questions, because that established a certain thing. He said, he asked Sri Aurobindo, do you not refer to the mother, our mother, in your book, The Mother? Do you not refer to the mother, our mother, in your book, The Mother? Sri Aurobindo, yes. Question, is she not the individual divine mother who has embodied the power of these two vaster ways of her existence, transcendent and universal? Sri Aurobindo, yes. Very crucial questions. Next, has she not descended here amongst us into the darkness and falsehood and error and death in her deep and great love for us? Yes. So the fundamental link was established, that what we are going to read about the mother in this book and the mother whom we see in the photograph is one and the same. He is not referring to any other mother. It is not a divine, universal mother concept. It is not the mother of the universe, nothing of that. He said, this book, this mother is, and that mother are one and the same. So these simple questions were important to establish the link between this and that. And I suppose these questions were necessary because in those early days, there was a lot of resistance from the sadhaks to accept the mother as the divine. Today, those who want to accept, it's easy. Accept her as the divine. It is easy, although even today we may have a lot of people doubting her divinity. It's but natural. In those early days, there were sadhaks who could not believe, who did not want to accept. You see, basically, if I can analyze and get into some kind of a understanding, you see, in India, we had always had the concept of the avatar as a male figure, male personality. We had the concept of the goddesses, for sure. But the avatar was always the male. Even conceptually, it was never described in the Puranas that there will be a female avatar or an incarnation. So philosophically, traditionally, that must have been, if I'm not too wrong, the obstruction to accept the mother as the divine incarnation. He says, Sri Aurobindo, we accept you as an incarnation. But how can there be a female? Because we have never been told about that. Our tradition in India does not speak about a female divine incarnation. Our Kalki is also a male figure, the Kalki avatar. So this must have been the concept. And it took a lot of time, a great resistance for this concept to be broken. So perhaps that is the reason why Sri Aurobindo had to write about this book, in this book about the mother. And these questions were answered in detail to say, yes, the mother is the incarnation. Although your tradition does not speak about it, but that's the truth. And of course, subsequently we come to know, for the supramental yoga, there was an absolute necessity of the twin avatar or the dual avatar of man and woman. They're coming in male and female form, because there are two different aspects of the divine, the consciousness and the Shakti. Well, we'll get into that when we come to that. So these were the resistances that were there at that time. So I'm sure from the time he wrote this, that resistance broke down slowly. Ultimately, there was one person who most of you know, Dilip Kumar Roy, who was a great sadhak, a great consciousness, who had almost met almost all the great figures of his time, politicians, sadhus, yogis, sannyasins. He was truly a seeker, a spiritual seeker. And ultimately, he comes to Mother and Sri Aurobindo. And as we are told, some of you, you have the Dilip Kumar Roy's correspondence with Sri Aurobindo. He had written almost 9,000 letters, because Dilip Kumar was truly a great intellect. And at the same time, a great devotee, who when he sang bhajans for Lord Sri Krishna, Sri Krishna himself would come and dance in front of him. You see, Dilip Kumar was sitting in that hall where we have the darshan, where we go to the darshan, where there's Sri Aurobindo and the mother's picture in that hall. And Sri Aurobindo and the mother would be in their room, where Sri Aurobindo's bed is there. And many a time, umpteen times, whenever Dilip Kumar Roy sang beautiful songs of bhajan invoking Lord Krishna was there actually dancing in front of him, which Sri Aurobindo and the mother could see. Dilip himself was not able to see. But what I want to mention is, such was his transparency, such was his contact with Lord Krishna. And yet, he could not accept the mother as the divine incarnation. He had great relations with the mother. He had beautiful correspondence. Mother would always love him and tell him what to do and guide him and all that. But somewhere the inner being was not able to accept her. Because I can imagine he was so completely wedded to Sri Krishna consciousness that he could not accept the divine Shakti consciousness, because in the Bhagavad Gita itself there is no divine Shakti. There is only the Purushottama. So that also tells us quite a few things. That here was a man who lived in the ashram for decades together, who was a great devotee and a favorite of Sri Aurobindo as a devotee, who knew the mother, saw the mother every other day, and yet because your consciousness is stuck on a particular level called the over-mental Godhead, you could not accept the mother. So what does it tell us? That truly we need to break the molds of the old consciousness. We must kind of make ourselves open to that extent where the mother and Sri Aurobindo tell us, forget, discard, throw behind all your godheads, all your old religion. It's only then that we can open ourselves to the new consciousness that is here. So I would read into Dilip Kumar Roy's disbelief of the mother in that manner. So even now, if you are wedded to the old deities, old concepts, you will have resistance to accept the mother. But let me be very blunt. In integral yoga, if you want to do Shivabindu sadhana without accepting the mother, there is no chance of one's progress, spiritual progress. So it is not the question of saying mother was a great administrator, great manager, but whatever her guidelines have been there for Auroville were of those bygone decades. That she was in the 60s, what she said belonged to 40 years back, and now we can build Auroville in our own vision. There could be all the logic behind it, but there cannot be, it cannot be a spiritual truth. It only means that we are not being open to the mother within, because that is where the mental block is coming up. So, the divine consciousness, the mother, does not belong to 60s or 50s or 40s or 30s. Her wisdom, her vision are really eternal. They have no time span. It is only our sorry state of consciousness that we are not able to understand her and be open to her. So the first thing that we have learned when reading the mother or when we lived with the mother was not to question her. Small or big, important or unimportant, first thing we said, mother said, and say fini, say final. So it is not that we just quote the mother, but mother's saying was itself the last word. I mean, I've told you many a time my own failure to understand the mother. Because then she said, it is your consciousness at which you are now that you are not able to understand what I'm saying now. So you see, I mean, these are little hints that we got in our life, but they are great lessons. That a plain word of the mother written to me in three lines, in three words, I'm not able to understand because of the status of my consciousness. And at that time, as a child, as a youngster, I did not challenge her, but I questioned her and I said, no, mother, I don't understand. Please explain. What is it all about? Mother just said, because of your level of consciousness, you are not able to understand. So I would extend the same example to all of us at present to say, let's not question her vision. If this single line is true forever, how can we ever even think of questioning her? Because either somebody asked me the same question, either I said, do you believe in Sri Aurobindo? If you question the mother, it means you are disbelieving in Sri Aurobindo itself, himself. Because if Sri Aurobindo writes that this, the one whom we adore as the mother, is the divine conscious force that dominates all existence. Do you understand the meaning of that? Is it she belonged to 1960 or 1950 or 1940? The one who dominates all existence, all creation. Either you believe in Sri Aurobindo or you don't believe. So friends, it is not the question of mother belonging to this decade or mother is this in this form. She is the one who has all the trinity of consciousness. That's why I suppose it is very good that we have taken up an understanding of the mother at the end of a preparation of a year and a half about the yoga aspect. Because having seen what are the principles of yoga, we must now understand, to whom do we offer ourselves? To whom do we surrender ourselves? Who is the person who is central to integral yoga? I mean, it is not Sri Aurobindo who would guide us on the day-to-day level. It is she. She is the transformative force. He is that great transformative consciousness. So in yoga, we need that force of transformation. So it is not to exaggerate when we say that without the mother, there is no integral yoga at all. Either you take her up fully as you take up Sri Aurobindo. Well, yes, I can understand that some people have gotten entrance through the door of Sri Aurobindo into the mother. Others have come via mother into Sri Aurobindo. And to some, Sri Aurobindo may appeal to a mental consciousness. The mother appeals more to the psychic inner consciousness of emotion. There could be some kind of a little forward and backward movement, or one part and the other part. Although mother would say, it is only when you understand that the mother and Sri Aurobindo are one and the same, and when you think of one, you think of the other inseparably, invariably, then you have the supramental consciousness. That is one of the signs that you are open to the supramental consciousness. When to think of the mother is to think of Sri Aurobindo is one word. It is Sri Aurobindo Mira Sharanam is one word. The Sri Aurobindo Mira is one word. It is not Sri Aurobindo and Mira. It is not mother and Sri Aurobindo. So when she says, when you have this singular consciousness of seeing them both as one and the same, you are open to the supramental consciousness. So when many a time, you know, it was now many, quite many years back, when we used to sit with Champaklalji, and talk to him about his days with the mother, he talked to me about one vision he had in the Matri Mandir. It was not built, you know, in those days. There's no earth, there's nothing there. The crystal wasn't there, nothing of this, just being built. And yet in that unbuilt chamber, when he went for the first time, he saw mother and Sri Aurobindo completely united there in the Matri Mandir. It was not the crystal, it was not the symbol, it was nothing, it was just an empty shell. But his vision was to see them together as one body. So he said, you see, they are already there. She is already there, he is already there. That means the one presence of the supermind is already there. It is not necessary that she and he and they manifested after the crystal was put in. The day the Om was written on the stone and that Om was put as the foundation stone of Auroville, she manifested herself in matter. So their manifestation was long back in 1972 itself. It is only that force which built itself. Yesterday we were with Tina and she read out a beautiful quotation from the mother, where she says, in spite of all of you, in spite of all of us, Matri Mandir and Auroville will be built. Because it is she who is doing it. So oftentimes when we have problems here, there, everywhere, which are there now everywhere, let us remember one thing, that this city and everything around it will be built by her and him, not by you and me. We are really puppets in the hands of the forces. So sometimes it is a bit depressing, dissuading, but if you remember that she is the builder, and she is the builder not just of Matri Mandir, not just of Auroville, but she is the creatrix of the whole universe. Can we remember that? Then we can progress in our sadhana pretty undisturbed. Otherwise, the external circumstances are too brutal and they may disturb our sadhana. But I thought, if in this moment of a great cyclone that is going over our heads physically, psychologically, mentally, if we can hang on to that consciousness, if we can, I would put it bluntly in my very personal way, if we can hold on to her feet, all the storms will go over your head. Hold on to her feet. Just cling, mother says, to truth. But I would personally say, cling to her feet. That is the only solace and that's the only promise. So friends, from next time, we will take up the chapter by paragraph by paragraph, line by line. Maybe I'd put it word by word. Because the first three paragraphs are so compact that I may take another 1 year to explain only three paragraphs. So do not be surprised. But that is the beauty, as I said, this is the seed of your entire Savitri, of Life Divine, of Synthesis. So it's for all of us to give ourselves time. We give 2 years or 1 month or 3 years and say, Anand, we had enough. Or we'll say we go on forever. Well, thank you for this first day. We will be meeting here in all our classes, because we had planned to video these classes for the benefit of not only at Sakar what we want to do, but Shadavan herself suggested we could keep in the archives this explanation of the mother. And I thought it would be useful for building up Savitri Bhavan's archives itself. So we have better facilities for videoing and the sound, etc. So please come here every Monday and we'll have the same thing. So from next Monday, we will have the class. But if you can buy this one, I'm not an agent of Shraddha, but if you can buy this one, it will be useful. Not that it has all the comments. This is called The Mother by Sri Aurobindo, with the mother's comments. So I'd be using a lot of these comments, but very interestingly, it was perhaps in 1997 or so that I first started so-called my career as a speaker with the workshop on the mother. And at that time, I had this book. Same book in a different edition, The Mother with the Mother's Comments. So I've used this book extensively to really explain something from the mothers. So if you have not bought the book, and if you can buy the book, it's available in Shraddha. I got it day before yesterday. It will be useful. But for Sri Aurobindo's comments, we still have to use his volume 25, SABCL. But for the mother's comments, we have in this book. So it will be useful if you can bring it. Otherwise, if you cannot, at least have the copy of the book, The Mother. Yes? I think we will stop here for the day.